Good evening, everyone. We'd like to welcome you to Newness of Life World Outreach Center Tuesday night Bible study. We just welcome you tonight. If you are watching by way of media, whether that be YouTube or Facebook, we want to encourage you to like, to love, and to share with a friend, family members, or maybe perhaps someone who don't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. If you are watching, I want to encourage you tonight to get your Bible, get your electronic device. Make sure you have a notebook or a pad and a pen so you can follow along with me and so we can learn together. Amen. At the end of the service, you will have an opportunity to give into the ministry, and you may do so by going to our website, nloc-outreach.com. That's nloc-outreach.com. Click on the Give Online button and you can sow your tithe and your offering there. Of course, this is good ground to sow seed, and so we want to encourage you to do that. We're going to pray and we're going to go ahead and get into the Word of God tonight. Father, we are so grateful for you being in our lives. We thank you that we are the righteousness of God and Satan has no power over us. And so, Holy Spirit, we sit here tonight. I know the table has been laid, and so we sit at your table tonight and we eat from the table. Those things that you desire to articulate through me to your people tonight, I yield myself totally to you. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that the word of God will fall on the good soil of our hearts tonight. It'll bring about change in all of our getting. We'll get understanding. We are expecting the anointing to be present to remove every burden and to destroy every yoke of bondage. And Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, on last week, I had begun a series on titled The Secret to Life. The title of that series, again, is The Secret to Life. And in that series, we will be talking about the fruit of the Spirit is the gift to the righteous. The fruit of the Spirit is the gift to the righteous. And so if you are a believer, everything that Christ is and has, you now are and you have. You have access to God the Father. You have access to the Son, Jesus, and you have access to the Holy Spirit. So therefore, the Holy Spirit is a part of you. Everybody say that. The Holy Spirit is a part of me. He lives on the inside of you. The Holy Spirit is one of the greatest gifts or promises that we could ever receive in life, because when Jesus finished his work on the cross, when he died for our sins and he gave us salvation and deliverance and prosperity and health and wholeness, he said it is finished. So he now sits on the right hand of the Father, but he left us with a helper. The Holy Spirit is there to help and to assist us. And so he can help you with a lot of things in life. But there are five things that the Lord had placed on my heart to share with you. So the Holy Spirit is given to us to help and assist us. He will help you with 1, producing the right fruit in your life. 2, the Holy Spirit will help you with developing the right character and attributes. The Holy Spirit will help you in making the right decisions in life, because sometimes we don't know which way to go or what decision we should make, but the Holy Spirit is there to help you with that. He will help train you on how to hear and listen for the voice of God. The Holy Spirit will also help you to live a successful life. And so we need the Holy Spirit. And the Bible has already declared in 2 Peter 1:3 that God has given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. So we have everything that we need. But the Holy Spirit is here to aid and to assist us. So it is very important moving forward, again, is to understand that the Holy Spirit plays a huge and significant role in our communication, how we communicate with the Father and with Jesus, and also how we grow, the growth process. It is necessary for us to live with the Holy Spirit, not apart from the Holy Spirit, because again, the Holy Spirit has purpose in our lives. Amen. On last week, we established that it is through the Holy Spirit that our spiritual fruits, our spiritual gifts, and our godly characteristics are produced in our lives. It's how the Holy Spirit has gifted us. It's how he has put those things on the inside of us. Remember, he has given us everything that we need to live a successful Christian life. Everything God created, he created to bear fruit. Let me say that again. Everything God created, he created to bear fruit. He created the animals. The animals create, they bear fruit. He created trees. Trees bear fruit. He created mankind, and mankind has to bear fruit. So God wants his people as believers, all of us as believers, he wants us to bring forth fruit and exercise spiritual gifts. Now, I just for clarity, I want to explain to you the difference between the fruit and the gifts. We have spiritual fruit and we have spiritual gifts. The spiritual fruit are the characteristics and the attributes of Christ and the Holy Spirit. Our spiritual fruit is produced, is a process. Let me say that, because a lot of times we think that everything just happens like microwave mentality. But spiritual fruit is a process of a gradual growth and needs to be cultivated deliberately. Let me say that again. Spiritual fruit is a process of a gradual growth. So it takes time. It takes time to cultivate and to grow. And you do that deliberately, intentionally. You do that. Okay? Let me define the spiritual gifts. The spiritual gifts are the abilities and the power of God given and received in a single transaction. And what you may say, well, what do you mean by that? Take, for instance, a Christmas tree. During Christmas time, if I have purchased a gift and I want to give that gift to someone, well, I am the giver of that gift. And then that person is the receiver of that gift. Within that same transaction, I'm giving the gift and that person receives the gift. So it is with our spiritual gifts. God gives it to us and then we receive that in a single transaction. We cannot earn it. The Holy Spirit expresses his character in action through our gifts. Okay. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention and bring clarity to it, because a lot of times, we mix up the fruits and the gifts, but they are different and they serve purpose, but they work together. Okay. They work together. Again, the Holy Spirit is the giver of our fruits and our gifts, and they are free. All we have to do is to receive. On last week, we started with our foundational scripture, which came from Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 25. And we're going to go back to that tonight. So if you have your Bible and if you have your electronic device, please turn with me to the book of Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 through 25. And I'm going to read it to you out of the Amplified Translation. And it reads, "But I say, walk habitually in the Holy Spirit, seek him and be responsive to his guidance. And then you will certainly not carry out the desires of a sinful nature, which responds impulsively, thoughtlessly, without regard for God and his precepts." Verse 17. "For the sinful nature has its desire, which is opposed to the Spirit, and the Spirit are in direct opposition of each other, continually in conflict. So that you as believers do not always do whatever good things you want to do." Verse 18. "But if you are guided by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law." Verse 19. "Now the practices of the sinful nature are clearly evident. They are sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, total irresponsible and a lack of self-control, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, strife, jealousy, fit of anger, disputes, dissensions, and factions that promote heresies." Verses 21. "Envy, drunkenness, riotous behavior, and other things like these. I warn you beforehand, just as I did previously, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God." Now, everything we read from verse 16 through 21 was your nature before you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Now, everything that we will read from verses 22 through 25 is the nature that you receive after you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. So here, a transition has taken place from the old nature and to the new nature. Okay, so let's read starting with verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within us, is love, unselfish concern for others, joy, inner peace, patience. And patience is not the ability to wait, but how we act while we're waiting. Goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Verse 24. And those who belong to Christ Jesus has crucified the sinful nature together with its passions and appetite. Verse 25. If we claim to live by the Holy Spirit, verse 25 again, if we claim to live by the Holy Spirit, we must also walk by the Spirit with personal integrity, godly character, moral courage, our conduct empowered by the Holy Spirit. Now, our focus as believers should be on the fruit of the Spirit and not the old things that we've had habit of doing. And remember those things that we read from verse 20, from verse 16 to verse 21 were a part of your old nature. Now that you are in Christ, you have a new nature. And God has, the Holy Spirit has seated you and gifted you with the fruit of the Spirit. And they now resides on the inside of you. Okay? So remember now, your spiritual fruit is a process of a gradual growth, and it needs to be cultivated. So that means you're going to have to nurture the fruit of the Spirit. You're going to have to develop the fruit of the Spirit, and you're going to have to do that intentionally. Purposely, you're going to have to do that. So we no longer should be focused on all those things that we used to do or all the bad habits we used to have. The Holy Spirit is saying, now I want you to focus on the fruit of the Spirit. Those are things that are pure and honest and of good report. Those are the things that we have to put our attention into and focus on, okay? All right. So we want to make sure that we understand that we have to choose to cultivate the fruit of the Spirit. This is not something that, I guess, and I'm hoping and I'm praying, this is something that you're going to have to choose to do as a believer. Because remember, it's a part of you. So it's in there. It's almost like ragu. You know, I always use that analogy like ragu sauce. You know, all the ingredients is in there. Is in there. When you get ready to make that spaghetti, you put that ragu sauce on there. Everything you need is in there. So it is the same. Everything you need is on the inside of you. So you have the capability and you have the ability to exercise and walk in the fruit of the Spirit. Okay. So tonight we are going to begin with the fruit of love. So tonight we're going to begin with the fruit of love. There are 9 fruit. And the fruit of love is the one that we are going to begin with. Now, some of the fruits we will group together in a cluster because they are interchangeable. They are similar and they kind of flow together with each other. So, you know, as we walk through this series, some of the fruits we are going to kind of cluster together. But tonight we want to talk about love. And I want to take my time with love because love is the primary or the key, or it is key in our Christian faith. Love is primary and it is key in our Christian faith. It should occupy a place of importance like nothing else in our lives. Let me say that again. Love should occupy a place of importance like nothing else in our lives. Love is the chief, it is the leading or the dominant characteristics that we can produce or exhibit in our lives. The fruit of love is the one thing that ties the other fruits together, and you'll see that. So we got 9 fruits, And the chief characteristic is love, and then all the other fruits hang on the fruit of love, okay? So let's begin by talking about the four types of love. We're going to mention the four types of love. So the four types of love is this. Number one is eros or eros. That is what you would call the erotic or the passionate type of love. That's the sexual love that you will have towards the opposite sex. So we got four types of love or four natures of love. And the first one is eros. Okay. The second type of love is philia, filio, however you want to pronounce it. Some pronounce it philia, some pronounce it filio. That is a friendship type of love. That is a love of friends. That's a love that shares equal agreement. Okay, so that is a friendship type of love. Then we have the love called storge. And that love is an affectionate love, a love that you will have towards your parents, your children, a family member, you know, a loved one. That's the affectionate type of love. And then the last love that I want to mention, this is last, but it's definitely not least. It is agape. Agape love is God's unconditional love. It is pure. It is enduring. And it is endless. Let me say that again. Agape love is God's unconditional love. His love is not based upon conditions. It's unconditional. It is pure. It is ending. And it's an endless love that is manifested by God himself. Okay? So I want you to make note of that. It is a pure, ending, endless love that is manifested by God himself. So the love that we want to focus on is agape love, okay? All the other loves are important, but we want to focus on agape love. And so point one for tonight, I want you to understand that God is love. And we're going to see that in the scripture. If you go with me to 1 John chapter 4, verses 8 through 12. 1 John chapter 4. Verses 8 through 12. Again, that's 1 John chapter 4, verses 8 through 12. And I want to read this out of the Amplified Version, and then we will read it out of the Message translation, okay? So, again, God is love. That's your first point as it relates to agape love, okay? 1 John chapter 4, 18 through 12, Amplified Translation. This one who does not love has not become acquainted with God, does not and never did know him. For God is love. He is the originator of love, and it is an enduring or an enduring attribute of his nature. Let me read that again. God is love. He is the originator of love, and it is an enduring attribute of his nature. Verse 9, by this, the love of God was displayed in us. So in other words, we have the love of God on the inside of us. It is displayed where? Within us. In that God has sent his one and only begotten Son, the one who is truly unique, the only one of his kind, into the world so that we might live through God. So God lives on the inside of us, and we live through God. We live through his fruit, his characteristics. We live through his attributes. We live through his love, okay? Verse 10, in this is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation, that is the atoning sacrifice and the satisfying offering for our sins, fulfilling God's requirement for justice against sin and placating his wrath. So God is love, okay? He first loved us. God first loved us. And I think it's very important that we understand that we serve a God that is a God of love. And not only that he loves, but he loves us. Okay? God is a God of love. Let's go to verse 11. It says, "Beloved, if God so loved us in this incredible way, we also ought to love one another." So if we are a part of God and God lives on the inside of us and God is love, then we are to love the way God has loved us. And we have that capability and the ability on the inside of us to do that. Okay? Verse 12. "No one has seen God at any time." We hadn't physically seen God with our natural eyes, but we've sensed him. Okay? But then it says, "But if we love one another with unselfish concern." So this says a lot to me. How is it that we love? We love one another with unselfish concerns. That's key. God abides in us, and his love, the love that is the very essence, abides in us and is completed and perfect or perfected in us. So God's love in us is completed. It's perfect. So you have, again, the ability to love. It's a choice. We get to choose how we are going to love or when we're going to love. But we have it on the inside of us. So it's really no excuse, okay? "For he who doesn't love doesn't know God." And I want to bring that out because you do not know him by experience as a God who loves unconditionally. So when you don't love, that means you don't know God. That's because you've never experienced the love of God. Because if you have experienced God's unconditional love, you don't have, as a believer, you shouldn't have a problem with loving someone else. Okay? Your love grows by your relationship with the Father. Let me put that out there. It is impossible for us to love God and to love someone else without the Holy Spirit. We cannot do it without his work. That's why God, everything that God put in place, everything that Jesus gifted us with and blessed us with, he didn't forget about anything. So we have that on the inside of us, but we can't do this without the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our helper. He's here to help us to love people, even when they are unlovable or when we think that they are unlovable. Because in God's eyes, no one is unlovable. There is nothing that you could ever do in life that will stop God from loving us, because he is a God of love. That is the essence of who he is. He cannot go against his word. He's not a God that he shall lie, nor is he the son of man that he shall repent. If he says that he is a God of love, he is a God of love. That means he loves you. And in the scripture, we've seen in the scripture where not only that he chose to love us, but he also put that same love on the inside of us. Okay? So there's a lot of things that you can do in life, but you cannot love without having the Holy Spirit to help you. Let me read this to you out of the Message translation, okay? The Message translation reads this way. It says, "My beloved friends," and I love this. It says, "Let us continue to love each other, since love comes from God." Let me say that again. "Let us continue to love each other, since love comes from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and experiences a relationship with God." So, see, you cannot love without experiencing or having that relationship with God. Once you have that intimate relationship with him, he'll teach you how to love. He'll show you how to love. He'll show you how to respond and react to people that is not kind to you. Okay? So everything who loves is born of God and experiences a relationship with God. The person who refuses to love doesn't know the first thing about God. Wow. The person who refuses to love doesn't know the first thing about God, because God is love. So you can't say that you love God, but you refuse to love other people. That is impossible. Because if you love God, and if God lives on the inside of you, you love other people. That's what the word says. That's not what Pastor Pat says, but that's what the word says. So the person who refuses to love doesn't know the first thing about God, because God is love. So you can't know him if you don't love. You cannot know God if you don't love. This is how God showed his love for us. God sent his only son into the world so we might live through him. This is the kind of love that we are talking about. Not that we once upon a time loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as a sacrifice to clear away our sins and the damage they've done to our lives or to our relationship with God. Verse 11, my dear friends, if God loved us like this, we certainly are to love each other. No one has seen God ever. But if we love one another, God dwells deeply within us, and his love becomes complete in us, that perfect love. You love God and you love others because that is a display of the character of God. Everybody gets to see your characteristics. They're on display. Everybody does. So God sent his love or gave his love to us. And because and how we love God and how we love others, it is a display to everybody that we come in contact with of who Christ really is. So the same love that God loves with is the same love that he put on the inside of you and me, because he is a God of love. Wow. Well, you know, my time is up. We're going to continue on next week talking about love. We'll probably talk about love for the next couple of weeks. And so, again, love is the chief fruit or the chief characteristics of all the fruit. And then the rest of the fruit really hangs on the spirit of love. Amen. I'm so glad that you tune in tonight. We're going to pray. Father, we are so grateful tonight that we are learning things about you, and we're learning that you are a God of love, and that is so important. You first loved us. You chose us. You chose to love us. And then not only do you love us, but the same love that you love us with, you put that love on the inside of us. And so it now resides on the inside of us. God, you are such a great God, a mighty God, an awesome God. And we so appreciate how you've placed your love on the inside of us. And we say thank you. Now, Holy Spirit, we ask that you will help us and teach us how to love everyone. First loving God and then loving everyone that we come in contact with. Father, we thank you for that, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you are out there and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there is no way that you could ever, ever exercise the love of God towards mankind if you don't first know that God loves you and that he's a God of love. But first thing is first, in order for you to experience God's love, and in order for you to have that love placed on the inside of you, you must accept him as Lord and Savior. So it's just a simple prayer. Just do that with me. Say, Lord, I believe that you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross for me. I believe that in my heart, and I'm now confessing that with my mouth. I ask that you come live in my heart and be Lord over my life. And I accept you as Lord and Savior. in Jesus' name. If you prayed that simple prayer, then you are now in the household of faith. You are now a believer. You are now a born-again Christian. You are now a child of God. You are the righteousness of God. And so that means that you receive Jesus Christ, and you also have received the Spirit of God, and it now lives on the inside of you. It doesn't stop there. You may ask the question, what's next? You can go to our website. And on our website, there's information for you to gather on what's next. So once you've given your life to Christ, then you need to know what you need to do next. And so we want to share that information with you. Just please feel free to go to that website and gather that information. Amen. Remember, you have an opportunity to go to our website, nloc-outreach.com, and give if you want to sow your tithe tonight, if you want to sow a seed. This is good ground. Again, you have that opportunity to do that. Thank you for tuning in again tonight. And remember, Jesus is Lord, and we will see you on next week.